Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the EVPN VXLAN Anycast Gateway feature. Now, if you like my content so far, and if you're interested in seeing more networking and telecom technologies simply explained, then please subscribe now to the channel. And when you do subscribe, make sure to enable notifications like so that you'll be informed of new content. If you like this video, please do click that thumbs up button. In a couple of previous videos, we took a look at how to employ routing on a VXLAN topology that is using an MP-BGP EVPN control plane. We examined how we must create a transit VNI to carry that inter-VNI traffic from VNI 6501 to VNI 6502 in this particular example here. Now, in that example, we created a default gateway at each VTEP for the local VNI that is being served. So here for VNI 6501, we've created an SVI with an IP address of 192.168.12.1, which acts as the default gateway for all the hosts within that VNI. We've done something similar here on VTEP 2 for VNI 6502. Now, all of this works fine if we assume that our VNIs are local to each VTEP. However, the great advantage of VXLAN is that you can span your layer 2 networks using VNIs across the whole VXLAN fabric. So what happens if we configure this VXLAN fabric to have VNI 6501 span to VTEP 2 as well? And what if we connect PC3 here and configure it to be on VNI 6501, that is, on the same subnet as PC1? What default gateway will it use to communicate outside its own subnet? So let's say that PC3 wants to send a packet to PC2. If we were to use the same VLAN 12 SVI on VTEP 1 as the default gateway for PC3, then you would need to have the traffic traverse the VXLAN topology over VNI 6501 to get to this SVI, to be routed, and then to be sent again over the transit VNI 6500 to get to PC2. You can easily see that this solution is not efficient nor scalable. An alternative solution to this is to use the EVPN Anycast Distributed Gateway feature. Let's take a look at what that is and how it works. Now, to make room, I've made these entities here a little smaller and moved them over. They're still on VTEP 2, but we're not focusing on those for now. Now, just like in the last video, these little router icons here aren't actual routers. They're just a depiction of the internal SVIs that have been configured within VTEP 2. Now, what Anycast Distributed Gateway does is it essentially creates a local SVI on each VTEP that will serve as the local gateway to that particular VNI. And we use the same IP address as the corresponding SVI on VTEP 1. Now, this is where the term distributed comes in. The default gateway for the subnet served by VNI 6501 is distributed among all the VTEPs that serve that VNI. And the term Anycast comes into play by using the same IP address on all default gateways on all VTEPs serving that VNI. Now, you may think that having a duplicate address on the network may cause a problem. However, the Anycast feature of IPv4 allows us to apply this solution. When PC3 tries to communicate with PC2, it will be routed to the local default gateway. Now, once routed to that default gateway, the MP-BGP EVPN VXLAN operation will be used to determine where the destination host resides. If it resides in the local VTEP, as is the case with PC2 here, then the packet will be directly routed via the VLAN 13 SVI to reach PC2. This is because the local VTEP can handle inter-VNI routing directly via the Anycast Gateway functionality, which enables layer 3 routing between the two local VNIs. If, however, the destination host resides on a remote VTEP, then it will be routed to the transit VNI via the VLAN 1213 SVI to be sent to the corresponding remote VTEP. Now let's take a look at the bigger picture. How does this work to scale? Let me explain this diagram. Here we have several VTEPs with PCs 1, 3, and 4 configured on the same subnet of 192.168.12.0/24. These are all on VNI 6501. Each PC is on a different VTEP. Now, each VTEP has configured a default gateway using the VLAN 12 SVI, and those default gateways are given the same IP address. That's Anycast in action. Now, each of those VTEPs is also configured with the transit VNI 6500 that corresponds to the VLAN 1213 SVI at each device. Now, when PC1 wants to communicate with PC2, which is on another VNI, VNI 6502, for example, it will go to its local default gateway and will do a VXLAN lookup and will determine that in order to get to the destination, it must go via the local SVI that corresponds to the transit VNI 6500. So it will be routed here and then go across the VXLAN fabric to VTEP 2. It will then be routed via VLAN 1213 SVI and then the VLAN 13 SVI to eventually reach PC2. Now, when PC2 responds, routing also takes place locally at the VLAN 13 SVI and then via the VNI 6500 to reach VTEP 1 and PC1. Now, the same process will take place at each VTEP that contains VNI 6501. PC3 here, for example, will communicate with its local default gateway to do a VXLAN lookup and determine that it must go to the transit VNI to reach VTEP 2 and be routed to PC2. Now, the great advantage here is that routing always takes place locally before the packet is sent out to the VXLAN fabric. So there's no need for packets to traverse the whole VXLAN fabric to be routed and then be sent along their way. It happens locally in every case, and that is part of the efficiency that this solution provides. But there's another great advantage as well. Let's say we want to move PC3 from this VTEP to this VTEP. It's as simple as unplugging it from this VTEP and plugging it into this VTEP here. You don't have to change any configuration on the PC. The only thing you have to ensure is that the port to which it's connected on the new VTEP is on the VLAN associated with our VNI 6501. Now, there's one last thing that we have to talk about when we deal with this distributed gateway feature. You may have already realized that although the default gateway IP address of all of the VLAN 12 SVIs that serve VNI 6501 have the same IP address, they by definition, however, have different MAC addresses. Now, because in modern data centers and cloud environments, virtual machines, containers, and other workloads often move dynamically between servers and locations for reasons including load balancing, scaling, and maintenance. In such an environment, however, there's a need to keep the MAC addresses of the distributed default gateways consistent throughout the VXLAN fabric. Now, I'm using labels such as PC1 and PC2 here, but these will typically be VMs or Docker containers that can easily move from one area of the cloud or data center to another. Now, take a look at this scenario. When container 3 here sends an ARP request to discover the MAC address of the local default gateway, it gets a response and puts the appropriate MAC address in the ARP table. Now, imagine that this container is dynamically moved from VTEP 3 to VTEP 4. The ARP table still has the MAC address of this SVI on VTEP 3 and not the MAC address of the local SVI, which should now be the local Anycast gateway. And this is a problem because all of a sudden, after the move, this device will no longer be able to access networks outside of its own subnet until it refreshes its ARP table. Now, the first solution to this problem is to do a manual MAC configuration. In this case, you would go into all of the VTEPs that contain VNI 6501 and manually configure the MAC address of the corresponding SVI to be the same. That way, any ARP requests that reach any of VLAN 12 SVIs on any VTEP will respond with the same MAC address. Now, as you can probably see, this is not very scalable. The alternative, which is a better solution and a more scalable solution, is to use what is called MAC aliasing. Now, in this diagram here, you can see that each local distributed gateway has the same IP address because of our Anycast distributed gateway feature, but a different MAC address. Now, MAC address aliasing allows these VTEPs to communicate with each other and inform each other of their MAC addresses. Thus, each VTEP has a list of all of the MAC addresses of all of the other distributed gateways and can use any of those MAC addresses to respond. So as you can see here in VTEP 4, it has a list of all the MAC addresses that correspond to the default gateways on all of the other VTEPs. So if container 3 here moves from VTEP 3 to VTEP 4, it will retain the MAC address of the default gateway of VTEP 3. But VTEP 4 also has that MAC address corresponding to the same Anycast IP address. So essentially, VTEP 4 can readily serve any frames destined for that default gateway. And that is how EVPN VXLAN Anycast Distributed Gateway works. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. And if you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.